Hello, and welcome to Education Pittsburgh. I'm your host, Linda DeAngelo. Education Pittsburgh is a forum for the discussion of just and equitable educational practices in the Pittsburgh community. Today, we'll be talking about college going for men of color, and I'll be highlighting the Brotherhood program. Brotherhood is part of Pitt Excel in the Swanson School of Engineering at the University of Pittsburgh. Among our topics today will be preparing for the first college year for men of color. Make sure to stay tuned for that discussion. My guest today is Dr. Simeon Saunders. Dr. Saunders is the Associate Director of Pitt Excel and the Professional Advisor of the Brotherhood Program. Welcome to Education Pittsburgh, Dr. Saunders. I'm excited to have you here to talk about the Brotherhood program. Why don't you start by telling us a little bit about yourself and about the Brotherhood program?
Yes, well, thanks for having me, Linda. I was born and raised in Aliquippa, Pennsylvania, Monaca area in Beaver County. Mm-hmm. And I went to undergrad, I got all my 3 degrees from the University of Pittsburgh. Pitt has been very good to me. And I went to undergrad, I majored in political science. And I got my master's degree in higher education management under your leadership, and then I got my doctorate in social and comparative analysis just recently from the School of Education. So, that's me in a nutshell. I really just have a passion for seeing young people succeed and fulfill their dreams and hopes and desires, and being a catalyst to help make that happen.
Okay, so tell us about the Brotherhood program and its mission, goals, and how it came to be developed.
Yes, so I was hired in the Pitt Excel office in 2010. Mm-hmm. And upon being hired, my director at the time was really looking for somebody to help engage the young men of color in the program. And I'm the kind of person I need to kind of see things to really understand it myself. And once I started really recognizing that, yeah, there was indeed a little bit of a problem. Some of the young men just weren't as engaged as they could have been. There was a lot of lacking of leadership and peer mentoring amongst the older men to the younger mm-hmm. men. And so I kind of took it upon myself to start organizing some events and some workshops to kind of just bring the guys together and instill that sense of pride and camaraderie and support. My first workshop I did was a workshop I entitled The Mask of Masculinity. And the idea of that was, you know, we as young men, sometimes we carry these masks, we wear these masks, and we try to hide ourselves from some of the stressors and issues that we deal with in school and in society, in our families and communities. And it's okay to take that off. It's okay to be vulnerable. And growth happens in our vulnerability. So those were the kind of workshops that I was doing. Mm-hmm. And we also did some social events. I did a flag football event on the muddy lawn of the Cathedral of Learning.
Oh, that must have been wild.
It was one of the funnest experiences of my time, actually. And then out of that, I saw that the younger ones really starting to come together and things are starting to happen, but the upper class students were still disengaged. They weren't really buying in. Mm-hmm. And so what happened was we were at our fall retreat, our annual fall retreat. This was the fall retreat of 2011. And I was having a conversation with one of the students when he was interested in going to graduate school, and he was asking me some questions about why he should go and why he shouldn't. And then one of the other young men, the upper class students, approached the conversation, and he said to the young man, don't listen to Sim, he doesn't know what he's talking about, you know, he can't be trusted. And I'm like, whoa, you know? And you know, obviously that kind of stirred me up a little bit, and we had a little verbal altercation. But once I kind of got to myself and took time out, I realized that this might have been about something more. And so mm-hmm. I went to approach the student, asked him to come talk to me on the hillside for a while. And he did, and we had a great conversation for about an hour and a half. And out of that conversation, I learned that the young man was really reaching out, and he really felt convicted and empowered by some of the work that was being done. He just didn't feel that there was any outlet or way to really express that. So I had him go and retrieve some of his friends, and We had a conversation in the evening for about 5 hours into the night in the woods. And we were talking about, you know, being men of color, being black men in this society and engineering and the struggles that, that comes with that and all that. And out of that conversation, really the Brotherhood was kind of formed, actually. And so that the rest of that year, we had workshops, and I included them in my workshops, and I had them kind of help me lead the workshops. And then it was that summer of 2012 is when I finally came together with those upperclassmen. It was about six of them. And we sat down, and I told them, I said, hey, we need an organization. I think we're ready. And they kind of collaborated with each other and worked with me. And we came up with the name Brotherhood, and we created a logo. And Brotherhood is an acronym. It stands for Brothers Respecting Open Thought, Helping Every Man Realize His Own Original Dream. And from that is how Brotherhood was started. It was officially founded in the summer of 2012.
Okay, so we're going into year nine then.
Yeah, year nine
coming up. So tell me a little bit about the goals that you established with these young men of color as you developed the program and how you see the program now.
So from that point in 2012 forward, we really started kind of refining and shaping the goals and the mission of Brotherhood. As men of color in engineering and in higher education in general, but certainly in engineering, there's a lot of stressors, a lot of hindrances, racial and microaggressions and a sense of loneliness and lack of being understood and stereotypes, a lot of things that are sometimes overt, sometimes are covert. But these kind of stressors can create really problems when it comes to academic and professional opportunities and development. And so what we wanted to do was create a space where the young men felt empowered and supported to really talk about things at their level without judgment, without ridicule, freely, to express their agency and have support with one another. And from those kind of brotherly bonds and those conversations and those dialogues and those activities, the hope was that what could happen is they would feel that sense of togetherness and support in a way that they can then translate into their classroom experiences with their professors and taking exams and the whole nine yards, leadership on campus. And so we use our tenets as our guiding framework that provide our kind of principles of what we talk about. And there's 25 of them, and the upper class students helped me create those. And out of those tenets is where we come up with our workshop topics and our themes, and it really kind of helps the guys stay grounded in something beyond themselves and something beyond those stressors and those issues that they deal with, and kind of help them reach a higher calling and a higher consciousness about who they are, their place in this world, their place in the School of Engineering, and that they can indeed overcome some of those obstacles.
You know, one of the special things about Brotherhood is that this was really developed from the ground up, really from the students and the men of color in your program, and that you really supported them in developing something that would support them.
Right.
So can you talk about how you see that as being important to the young men that started this, and also as it continues?
So our leadership structure is very different than most student organizations. We really create a sense of an expression of their individuality and their autonomy as leaders. And so in Brotherhood, there is no like hierarchical leadership. A lot of student organizations, you know, you have like a president and the treasurer and the vice president, these different kind of hierarchical positions. But in Brotherhood, it's just a kind of linear leadership. They're all like the president. They're all the leaders. And what that kind of creates is a sense of ownership and empowerment that they don't have to look over their shoulders and wonder, you know, be in competition with each other or wonder, you know, if this person likes me or if this person likes me. But it kind of creates this sense that we're in this thing together. We all have similar experiences, though we're diverse and though we're different, but we can come together around common goals and common causes for a larger purpose. And so the leadership structure is very unique, but it was designed for that for a strategic reason, to provide that sense of collaboration, unity, peer-to-peer engagement, and just that feeling of freedom to be who you are without having to feel like you have to change or put on a different face. And so we can address some of those issues that we talk about in our workshops.
So I understand you recently did outcomes assessment of Brotherhood. Can you tell us a little bit about what you found out and about how the program supports men of color in engineering?
Yes, so from that assessment, there were certain themes and topics that came out from the interviews that were done. And one of the big ones that came out was this idea of the students really seeing Brotherhood as a help for their understanding of masculinity and manhood, and also mental health support. The masculinity and manhood topic was really interesting because You know, engineering is a male-dominated field, sure. unfortunately, it continues to be. Mm-hmm. And even though these are men of color, and you know, they have that minoritized identity as being a person of color, but they're still men, you know, in a male-dominated field. So to hear the students talking about how it's challenging their notions of, you know, a man doesn't have to be this, you know, vibrato, chauvinistic kind of, you know, attention-seeking type of person, that you can be more subdued and you can be a little bit more aware of your privilege as a man, and particularly in this field, mm-hmm. And in the classroom and stuff like that. And so to hear the young men talking about how they're learning about themselves and that awareness as men and their place in society, to kind of create a more equitable and equal experience for all engineers in this profession and all people, mm-hmm. Particularly women. So that was really an important thought that came out. The other thing about mental health, that was really important. You know, mental health is obviously something that men of color really struggle with, and we really deal with. And there's when we talk about some of those stressors and hindrances, mm-hmm. this idea that we can't be vulnerable and we can't talk about some of the internal pains and emotions and trauma that we might have experienced in our lives. Mm-hmm. But what the guys were talking about is what Brotherhood creates, that space where we can talk about these things without, again, being ridiculed or without being judged. And to hear the conversations and to hear the stories and testimonies from different men peer to peer really creates for the guys a sense of belonging and a sense of understanding and appreciation for who they are, that they get these things off of their chest and really feel healthy about with the way they think about themselves, the things that they've experienced in their lives previously, and how to take negative experiences and kind of flip those on their head to become positive experiences. Mm-hmm. So these are the things that I think the assessment really kind of highlighted about that social emotional support and that clarity of thought and that understanding of who you are, your place in the world as a man of color, as a developing engineer.
Yeah, so this is really, you saw that they were getting these things and then really mental health support, and then also understanding who they could be yeah. as men, yes. and they can choose what that means for them.
Absolutely,
right?
Yes.
And how did you see that supported them in terms of their progression as engineers yeah. and then into their postgraduate life?
Yeah, tremendously, actually. You know, the young men are witnessing what it's like to not only cope, mm-hmm. but to overcome and subdue. Mm-hmm. Those are two different concepts, mm-hmm. right? So we talk about a safe space. Oh, it's a space where we can, you know, I'm experiencing these negative experiences and I don't like it and it makes me feel bad. Let me get around people and we can kind of like cry together and support each other. Well, that's necessary. Mm-hmm. But there's a part B to that. And the part B is, not only do we cry together and support each other, but let's take this thing by storm now. Let's take the lessons and let's take the camaraderie and let's actually change the conditions, right? Take advantage of leadership opportunities in the school and on campus. Mm-hmm. You know, don't be afraid to speak up and to speak out about things that you're seeing in the school, particularly as it relates to minoritized students and underrepresented students, to deans and faculty members and staff members, right? So when you see that kind of translate from their first year all the way until they graduate and beyond, and you're starting to see the things that they're taking advantage of, you know, taking advantage of being on student government board or being resident assistants and getting involved in research labs, going on to apply to graduate schools mm-hmm. and medical schools, it's really kind of a demonstration that how we feel oftentimes dictates where we're going and what we decide to take advantage of. So much of what we do depends on how we feel. And as men of color in a society where there's racism and stereotypes about being a man of color, to be able to kind of overcome that in this space mm-hmm. is really, really rewarding to see.
So both providing support and then allowing a place for a new thriving
yes,
to occur.
Exactly,
okay.
Yeah.
Now, is there a moment or story mm-hmm. that you could share with us mm-hmm. That you feel was particularly poignant in terms mm-hmm. of understanding how Brotherhood supports men of color?
Yes, yeah, so I there's actually two. So one student I had years ago who really struggled, like many mm-hmm. young engineers do in school engineering. Engineering is difficult, but mm-hmm. Struggled a lot, really wasn't taking advantage of certain experiences that he should have been taking advantage of, and wasn't connected with Brotherhood at first.
Mm-hmm.
Then he started getting connected with Brotherhood, and immediately things began to change. It was like a transformation. It was really fascinating to watch. as he was able to express himself and as mm-hmm. he was able to hear testimonies from other men, his peers, older peers, even younger ones, even myself. Mm-hmm. And as that student started engaging more and more in Brotherhood, you started to see his grades dramatically increase. He began to have really a presence. He got his first co-op. He got an internship. He started really developing meaningful relationships with the faculty in his department. And this student is now in his, I believe, his fourth or fifth year in his PhD program.
Wow.
Yeah, in engineering. And so, you know, to go from being mm-hmm. potentially kicked out of school because you're doing so badly to a PhD candidate in engineering is truly remarkable. Obviously, Brotherhood isn't the only thing that contributes
sure,
to that. It's a part of the ecosystem. But it's a little slice of pie. I like to look at that slice and say, that's our slice, and we're proud of that slice. And then there was another student who was going on for an interview when he graduated, and mm-hmm. he was, you know, in an interview, he was interviewing, wasn't getting jobs, but he had this one interview, and they're going through the interview, and then they get to, and he had it on his resume, Brotherhood, mm-hmm. and they get to Brotherhood, and he tells me that the interviewer was like fascinated with what this organization was. And he spent like 20 minutes talking about Brotherhood, and he says from that he really felt connected to the interviewer and to the people to the company, and he got that job. So it's also good to feel as if Brotherhood is also providing actual tangible opportunities beyond college for these young men.
Okay. Well, great. So I'd like to switch gears a little bit and have you engage a little bit more in your expertise around college going for men of color. As you and I both know and our viewers know, we have a whole new group of men of color heading off to college very soon. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So what advice or support could you offer if you could talk directly to each one of the men of color going off to college? What advice or coaching would you offer to them as they head off to college?
Yeah, very good question. You're not alone. You have to understand that going in. You're not alone. I know it can feel like you're alone. I know it can even sometimes look like you're alone, but you're not alone. There are experiences and there are people on college campuses that really do have your best interest at heart. Mm-hmm. And all of them look like you, mm-hmm. you know? And so it takes that courage and that commitment to say, I'm not alone. And to remove that mask of masculinity, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that be vulnerable. Vulnerability is the key to success. I know that sounds funny, mm-hmm. but it's really true. When you can say, because here's the thing about it, when you're saying I'm vulnerable, that means I need help. And that can lead you to reach out. Recognizing that you need help is the first step to getting help, right?
Mm-hmm.
And help is the thing that opens up doors. And so my biggest thing is start there. I'm not alone, it's okay to be vulnerable, number one. Number two, take advantage of the different, you know, different universities. Here at Pitt, we definitely have one that have like bridge programs, summer mm-hmm. bridge programs, you know, opportunities 2 or 3 weeks before the school year starts to kind of get acclimated to the campus. Take advantage of those. You know, in Pitt Excel, ours is called the Summer Engineering Academy.
Right.
University of Pittsburgh this year, the Provost Academy is something that they're doing.
Right.
Again, an opportunity to bring students on campus early. Those kind of opportunities, take advantage of those. You know, you're not going to miss much of summer for 2 or 3 weeks. You know, it's okay to, you know, vacation a little earlier, right? but why is that important? Because it gets you exposed before things get really hectic mm-hmm. and before some of those stressors get really real. It gives you an opportunity to see, hey, there are people that care about me.
Mm-hmm.
There are opportunities to plug into, peers and professionals to plug into. So plugging in, getting involved, allowing yourself to be vulnerable, and recognizing that you're not alone is the key to having a promising beginning to your first year. I always look at the first year as stages, you know?
Mm-hmm.
The first month, like that's a month that's just hectic for everybody. Everybody's going through the same things. But then as you start getting into that fourth month, getting closer to spring, winter break, you know,
mm-hmm.
Then becomes, you know, the classes and kind of midterms and how to really, you know, maybe you get your first F, you get your first D you've ever seen, you know? But I think what these stages kind of show us is you need help, and there are people and systems that are strategically put in place to provide the very help that you need. And if you can recognize that early and stay with that, no matter what your experiences may be, it might be a very difficult experiences. It might be joyous experience. No matter what it is, it plugs you in. And once you're plugged in, you got the power, you know? And you can carry that into your sophomore year, junior year, and things just really start happening for you as you move on.
Okay, so you're not alone.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Look for support.
That's right.
Right? Yep. Support is actually a good thing. Mm-hmm. There's lots of it in different places than you might think initially, right?
That's right.
And then take advantage of bridge programs.
That's
absolutely.
Right.
I did a bridge program mm-hmm. myself mm-hmm. and I met lifelong friends and
yes.
had a support network already
absolutely.
When I arrived at college. So I understand what you're talking about.
Yeah.
They're definitely great. And if you get offered a bridge program, go.
Go.
Right?
Go. Absolutely.
All right. Mm-hmm. Now, what about any advice specifically to black men of color mm-hmm. from the Pittsburgh community that'll mm-hmm. be heading off to college?
Yeah. Yeah. I think it's really important to know that if you're staying local, mm-hmm. that's great. Pittsburgh is a great community for support. And I think the one thing to know is don't be afraid, though, even if you're staying local, to branch out. So if you're at a community college, if you're at one of the local schools here, expand your horizon, mm-hmm. right? That's a process, because sometimes when you stay home, you're kind of, well, it's home, and I'm used to home, and I'm familiar with home. But study abroads and going on different trips, getting involved in student organizations, like a Brotherhood, for example, you know, that kind of take different trips or interact with different universities or different students from different universities around the country. As you start kind of getting connected, then that can allow you to feel more comfortable branching out. If you're going to a school away from Pittsburgh, don't forget home. Don't forget the people and the communities and the systems that help get you here,
mm-hmm.
you know? And I think that that's really important, because again, that's a part of being vulnerable as well. I think sometimes we as young men of color, we kind of take on this, you know, the opposite effect where it's like, okay, I'm the man and I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna show you, you have a chip on your shoulder.
Mm-hmm.
Take that chip off. Take that chip off, I promise you. I use sports and athletes as a lot of my metaphors for my guys. And I always tell the guys, the greatest athletes, the Michael Jordans, the LeBron James, the Muhammad Ali's, the Tom Brady's that we think about, they're oftentimes the guys who allow themselves to be vulnerable.
Mm.
They recognize their weaknesses. They understand that they need a team. They're only as good as their teammates are. You know, they practice and work hard. When we don't see them on Sundays or during the big games, what we see at practice, what we see in mini camp and preseason, they're the hardest working people. So I think what you have to understand is, even if you are already feeling empowered, you came up with a lot of support and you're really smart, you achieved and you're moving forward with confidence and pride, understand though, humility is also the key to really tackling some of those stressors and hindrances and frustrating points as a man of color at a predominantly white institution,
mm-hmm.
Whether you're at home or away from home. So that's what I would say.
Okay, mm-hmm. those are important things to think about for mm-hmm. men as they're heading off, men of color as they're heading off to college.
Yeah.
Now, what about for men of color that are entering STEM disciplines, mm-hmm. such as engineering? Is there any specific advice or support you would offer to them?
Yes, definitely. Plug into the minority engineering programs
okay.
that exist, like
okay.
PittXL. PittXL is
okay.
a minority engineering program. Look and look for those staff and faculty of color.
Okay.
A lot of times, the different faculty and staff of color that, and there's not a lot of them, unfortunately, it's just the way it is.
Mm-hmm.
But a lot of them are there, and they're looking to be mentors. They're looking, they know what it was like to be the only woman of color, man of color, you know, in a classroom of 50 people. They remember those days.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, I think one thing that the young men would find in they go into STEM fields is a lot of their support is found within staff and faculty of color who are strategically put at these schools. Some of them are administrators, some of them are faculty, some of them are staff, but really look for that. I think the other thing is, we talked about the bridge programs,
mm-hmm.
but your learning doesn't happen in the lecture hall itself. A lot of the learning happens outside the lecture hall.
Yes.
And so it's really important to create meaningful peer relationships, right?
I agree.
Not just party buddies.
Yes.
Although having party buddies.
Well, party
know.
Buddies
yeah,
are good.
Yeah, party buddies
are
good. Yeah, with the, you know, within moderation. Don't get kicked out of school and some party stuff. But those meaningful relationships, those mm-hmm. relationships where you can go across the hall and say, hey, Scotty, I don't get this problem, man. What do you got?
Mm-hmm.
You know, again, you're not alone. So this idea of being in a silo and I'm to myself and I got to do this myself, I got to prove people wrong, let that stuff go. You have the support strategically and organically embedded into the school experience as a STEM major. And the last thing to understand is STEM is the hottest thing going.
It is.
In that way for about 10, 15 years.
10, 15 years.
And it's all going to continue, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you're kind of a hot commodity. And, you know, you're kind of the thing. And as the technology continues to advance, as engineering and innovations continue to advance, you're front and center. So you have to understand that your future is bright. It's very bright. Mm-hmm. Some of your peers are going to graduate a lot of debt in some kind of major and have to, you know, not make a dime of what they thought they would be making. You're different. You know, you're going to be able to, you're going to walk away with a professional degree. You're going to be able to walk away earning the kind of salaries and the kind of income that is very promising to be a 20-year-old. And that's great. So if you can understand that, if I can get through these 4 or 5 years, get this degree, mm-hmm. no matter what it takes, no matter the obstacles, what awaits me is something that is going to be very, very rewarding, and you won't regret it a day in your life.
Yeah, it definitely can get hard. You know, I want to back up a little bit to what you were talking about, mm-hmm. about relying on your support network. Mm-hmm. Certainly research shows that men of color and people of color generally tend to think that they need to do all the mm-hmm. work mm-hmm. themselves.
Right.
But in actuality, this idea of peer-to-peer right. sharing and mm-hmm. teaching and mm-hmm. working through things is very important right. to success. And right. so certainly for these young men, definitely mm-hmm. get out there, yeah. get a support network, be working with your neighbors.
That's right.
You're actually even learning a lot more
That's
as
right.
you work through problems and doing that.
Absolutely.
And sticking with it, getting support, very
yeah.
important.
Yeah,
right?
Absolutely. There's an old movie, it's called Higher Learning. I used to watch it when I was young. I think I was like 12 or 13. And it's with Lawrence Fishburne and Omar Epps and Ice Cube. And I remember there's a scene where Lawrence Fishburne is playing a professor at a predominantly white school, and the young men are dealing with racism on campus, and they're sitting on the steps, and they're talking, and then the professor comes, and they're talking, and Omar says something like, what's the point of trying to learn about this system? I'm just a pawn like anyone else.
Mm-hmm.
And the professor says, and this was, I was always stuck with me throughout my youth, if used intelligently, a pawn can create a checkmate or become a very powerful player himself.
Mm.
I love that quote because mm. it's very true. How many days do we feel like pawns in a game, mm. especially as men of color, right? But what that professor, what that movie showed is that, yes, sometimes you feel like a pawn. You may even be a pawn, but guess what? If used intelligently, plug into a system, knowing your network, allowing yourself to be vulnerable, you can not only be a very powerful player, you can create a checkmate. Very, very special, and it's very, very true. I've seen it, I've witnessed it. Brotherhood has demonstrated the power of that.
Well, thanks so much for being on my show, Dr. Saunders. It's been wonderful to have you here to talk about the Brotherhood program and academic success and starting college for men of color.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you
for having me, Linda. I appreciate it.
You're welcome. Thanks to you out there watching. Go out and make a positive difference. This is Linda DeAngelo. See you next time.